Good evening, folks. How are y'all? Good. I'm going to shake y'all up just a little bit. That's what I'm here for. They told me I had about 2 hours, so I'm going to go to the restroom go now before we get started. But they look at us as heroes, and we have the honor, we have the pride, we have the commitment, we have the dedication to do the things that we do. We don't ask for praise, we don't ask for accolades, we don't ask for recognition. Anytime you see a firefighter that's interviewed after they save a life and the soot covers their face and the scars from going to an NBA or saving a heart attack victim, what's the first thing that they say? They say, "You're a hero." Just doing my job. Just doing my job. And Chief Metcalf talking about his family, getting me to crying up here already. I'm going to get started good before I do anything. But you know, one of the things that I always found when I was coming up through the fire service is mentors and leaders in the organization. I didn't know what the heck I was doing when I joined the Shreveport Fire Department in 1984. I was 18 years old, not very well educated, and the city of Shreveport and the fire department really gave me a hand up, gave me an opportunity to be with an organization, as you all are. Don't you love your fire departments? Don't you just absolutely love your brother and sister firefighters? It's not work. It's not a job. It's not even a career. I don't even know how to categorize it. We're out there by ourselves in the fact that we live with the people that we call brother and sister firefighters. I mean, that's if I had to go back to a place in time in my career that says, you know, when did you have the greatest, you know, moments in your professional career? It was at the fire station, man. It was being on the fire trucks, and nothing is ever greater than going out and serving the public and putting a house fire out, saving a child's life, going to an NBC and extricating somebody and having that person walk away. That's a bond that you guys and ladies have created with one another that you'll have for your whole lives. I saw me introducing the executive members of this organization as well as the past presidents. They're still here. You know why they're still here? Because they're family. You know, other people leave their jobs and then they retire and you never see them again because they don't want anything to do with their organizations. They want to get as far away as they can. Not the fire service, man. It's an awesome opportunity. But with that opportunity also comes a great, great responsibility. You have a charge to be the absolute very best. You know, every one of you in your organizations and the geographic areas that you represent in your towns and your cities and your areas of this state, you're a monopoly. When people call 911, they do not have an opportunity to have a operator answer and say, "Well, if you'd like a pretty good fire department, push 3. If you'd like a good fire department, push 2. Well, if you'd like the absolute best fire department, push 1. Do they? Absolutely not. When they call 911, they have one choice. You. And you show up at their door. And that means you have an overbearing responsibility to be the absolute best that you can. You have to be the best trained. You have to be the best skilled. You have to be the best educated. And it doesn't matter if you have a list of technical experience and certifications as long as you're armed. Because what are we doing a lot of times when we get in there? We end up being psychologists. We end up just counseling and comforting people. Because you know what? Although we know who those frequent flyers are that call 911, you know, we know who they are, we know who those people are. But most people call 911 one time, and it's on the worst day of their life. And we're responsible to show up there with the technical expertise, but we're also responsible to show up there with the compassion and the commitment to be able to understand that this is the worst day of their life. Even if it's our 15th call of the day, even if we've been up all night and we haven't had any sleep, even if we just left a house fire and the hose is still wet in the bed and we get called because a baby spit up down the street, what do we do, guys? What do we do, ladies? The bell rings, we get on the freaking truck and we go down there and we say, "How can we help you?" It's a new mom, she's 18 years old, she doesn't know what to do with this baby, but we do. We do, because we're trained in all of those things. And one of those is personal responsibility. To be the absolute very best, to be that person who has that skill set when you knock on the door. You know, when we have our rookies and we take them through basic training class in 16 weeks, we don't give them that patch until they pass all of basic training and they pass their EMT. And when we give them that patch, we tell them, we're giving you the keys to the city when we give you that patch. Because before you put that patch on your shoulder, you can't walk up to any house in the city of Shreveport and knock on the door and say, I'm here to help you. One, nobody's going to open the door, first of all. They don't know who you are. But that patch is your pass to every house and every business and every person in this community. You put that patch on your shoulder, and one day, they don't let you in their house. The next day, you are a hero on your first day. Because that patch, when they see that patch and they open up that door in your community, in your town, it doesn't matter if you have 100 people in there or you've got 200,000 like Shreveport does, that patch gets you in their door. And when you get in that door, what do? What do those people do? They don't even know who you are. They've never even seen you in their life. Remember when I told you that most people only call 911 one time in their whole life? They don't know you. You're a stranger. They let you in their house. They take you back to a bedroom. And what do? They trust you with their most precious possession. They put your child or their child in your hands, and they don't even know you. They let you take care of their mother, their brother, their sister, their father. They don't even know you because of that patch on your shoulder. Make no mistake about it. I tell people all the time, how many people, if I ask you to raise your hand, you could tell me right now the name of the best person on your department? How many? Nobody? You guys don't have any good people in your departments? I'll ask you again, so this is the participation card. If I ask you right now, you can name me one person in your department and say, man, that is the guy. That is the lady. Raise your hand. Most of you could. Okay. I always could in my fire department. I mean, we had one guy that was, you know, that would change from year to year, but I can name you that, man, that guy is the best guy in our fire department. Let me ask you the inverse of that. If I ask you right now, how many people can name the worst person on your fire department? Oh, I said, look, they're already raising their hands up there. Are you the worst person, or you just named the worst person in the fire department? Okay. You can name the worst person. And so I always ask the question, we know who the best person is on the fire department, but we also know who the worst person is in the fire department. Why is that person on the fire department? There are no bad firefighters. There are only bad fire officers. I'm going to say that again. Think about it. There's no bad firefighters. There's only bad fire officers. Because if there's a firefighter who's not doing his job on your department, if there's a firefighter not doing his job at your station, there is an officer responsible for that firefighter being on the job. And so you can go one of two ways. You can let that guy keep sliding through the cracks, or you can do what you need to do as your job as a supervisor and make sure that person, you don't have a leave limit. You don't say that's the worst guy in the fire department. All of our people are the same. And I had a guy that had been on about 8 years. I'd only been there about a year or two. And he made the mistake, and he was at a fire scene, and he was insubordinate to a captain on a fire scene. And that's a big offense, especially for me. I never tolerated insubordination. That's one thing you can't have. That's one thing at the station if you kind of have a back and forth. But when you're on a fire scene or you're in an emergency scene and an officer gives you a directive, that is not the time to have a discussion. It's not, how do we fight this fire by committee? It is, somebody has to be in charge. And when you give an order and when you give a directive, you expect it to be followed. And so that is a big no-no for me as fire chief. Not only was he insubordinate, but he was insubordinate on an emergency scene, which put lives at risk and danger, in my opinion. And so I called this young man into my office, and after he had been through the whole disciplinary process, and he's standing before me, and 8 years on the job, married, two little girls, and he's crying his eyes out. He's begging for his job. And I looked at him and I said, how did you get here? He said, well, I drove down I-10. And I said, no. How did you get in my office today? Because what you did on the scene 3 weeks ago didn't happen overnight. It was a behavior that was allowed to perpetuate and continue over his 8 years. And come to find out, that is exactly what happened. Because I talked to all of his officers who he had worked for before. I talked to all of his officers who had given him ratings over the years. And they said, oh, he's, He's always been that way. He's always been kind of arrogant, kind of a cocky guy. He just says stuff, and before, you know, we've always just said, well, that's just so-and-so, and he just, that's just the way he is. And that's just the way he was until he got to a point where he crossed that line. And he was insubordinate on the scene. And here I was with his fate in my hands, whether or not to fire this young man or to keep him on and see if he was salvageable or not. And so I took care of him discipline-wise, and then I called all the officers that had been his commanders over the years. And I said, what the heck happened? How did this guy go for 8 years and believe that he could say the things that he has said? And I've heard it all. I haven't been here my whole career, but I've heard it. And he got to a point where he believed that it was okay to say something like that to an officer. That didn't happen. I held the officers more accountable than I did that firefighter. You have to be able to practice disciplines. For some people, discipline is a four-letter word, and they think it's a bad thing. Discipline actually means training in Greek. And so a lot of people think, no, you know, discipline, that's, you know, I don't want to come down on my buddy, we fish together, I'm the captain here, I don't want to do anything bad or anything like that. Let me tell you something. Discipline is the only thing that holds the fire service together. It's discipline to do your job. It's discipline to take the training that you have to take. It's discipline to work as a synchronized team on an emergency scene. It's the only thing that makes us successful. And so, how many people are parents in the room? Raise your hand. Okay? You don't know who the worst firefighter is, but you know you've got a kid somewhere, right? Okay. Discipline, you know, when we do it on the fire service, you know, we take it personal, or I do as a supervisor, the mayor has to do it in her position, and the officers in here had to discipline somebody, we feel bad about it. And, you know, discipline should never be handed out as a form of punishment. Discipline should always be handed out as training. It should never exceed anything that's necessary to change the behavior that you are disciplining. You just don't want that individual to do it again. And so when I talk to people about discipline, they say, well, Chief, you know, that was kind of harsh and this and that. And I tell them, discipline is almost like a love language. And they said, no, I don't get that, Chief. And I said, what do you do for your children? Do you let your children do anything that they want to do? Do you let your children say anything that they want to say? Do you let your children steal from a store? No, absolutely not. Why? Because your children went in growing up morons, right? You don't want that to happen. Why do you do that? Why do you discipline your children? Because you love your children. And you want them to grow up and be responsible adults. You want them to grow up with good behavior. You want them to go to school. You want them to get educated. You want them to get married. You want them to have a family. Those are the things that you do. As an officer and people in leadership positions in this room, you should want the exact same things for the men and women that are under your charge. Not disciplining somebody and letting them get away with something. You may be thinking, oh, I'm doing them a favor. You're not doing them a favor. You're not doing them a favor. Look at the young men that ended up in my office who was insubordinate to somebody. They thought they were doing him a favor, just kind of letting it pass. Oh, you know, that's just Jimmy. That's just the way he is. And he ended up losing his job. And so remember that the next time you are disciplined, or that you have to provide discipline to somebody, is to get that person where they need to be. Excellence is never an accident. I don't hardly write anything down. I just usually speak off the cuff. But I wrote this down because I wanted to say it exactly. Excellence is never an accident. It's always the result of hard work, high expectations, sincere efforts, and intellectual execution. Choice and what you determine to be your path in life, not chance, determines your destiny. It's on you. I hope some of what I've said here tonight leads you to make the right and better choices in your career and your life, because in the end, it's not all about you. It's about your family. It's about the fire department. It's about your brother and sister firefighters. And more than that, it's about the community that you represent. That's why we're all here, after all. When we make good, selfless choices, take personal responsibility for our actions, and truly serve others from the heart, everyone benefits and shares and your overwhelming success. And so I look forward to reading about your fire departments. I look forward to seeing your fire departments in the paper and the continued great work that you do. And on behalf of the City of Shreveport and Mayor Ollie Tyler, I thank you so much. I'm honored to be here tonight. May God bless you and keep you safe.